Hi. We're back, I guess.
From the dead. Back from the dead.
For some people watching this, I'm sure we're back.
Right.
And those of you who I'm referring to are the ones who watched our exam prep on the 70-410 and 411 courses, or really exams, I should say. As a trainer, I get stuck in courses versus exams.
Yes.
But what we're going to do here is this is the exam prep for the 70-412 exam, as opposed to course.
Right.
So
we're configuring advanced services now.
That's right. If you have been here with us for the 410 and 411, welcome back. And if you're brand new here on the 412, we welcome you. And I will tell you that my name is Ed Lieberman, and I am a Microsoft certified trainer. I have been since pretty much at the Stone Ages, I think we were just discussing. And I currently work for a company called Train Signal, where I am the lead Windows Server instructor. Put that together, it lands me here doing an exam prep with you. With me today is...
My name is Cynthia Wang. I'm also a Microsoft certified trainer since... Well, I don't want to say the Stone Age. Let's just go with the 90s. That's close enough. I work for JDA TSG. I am a Exchange Premier Field Engineer. Of course, doing anything that's related to application servers, the foundation is operating system, and that's why we're here, Windows Server 2012.
Awesome. So welcome again, everyone, and let's go ahead and get started. I want to first explain to you kind of the process that we're going to go through. So we have these four footprints here, this little four-step process to becoming certified. And the first step, step number one, says identify certification goal.
What do you want to be?
That's right. Figure out what you want to be, what you want to do, and then look at the certifications that Microsoft has in place and figure out what exams you should be taking. Once you've determined an exam that you need to take, you go to step two, right? You put that second, that's why we have footprints down.
Yeah,
it's the second step. Is you want to find the gaps in your knowledge, right? There's certain objectives, and that's actually where we're going to spend the heart of, the first half probably of this session. We're going to go through those objectives. And so as you're hearing the different objectives, you can figure out what gaps maybe you're a little bit weak in. And then your job from there is to then, step three, fill those gaps. Okay, you need to go out there and get the extra experience, get the extra education, the extra knowledge, fill those gaps. And once you've done those three steps, well, that's where we get to the exciting part. We get to step four, which is,
take the exam.
Take the test. Right. Go take the exam.
Yeah. So see how you do.
What we're going to do here today, just to make sure that we're very clear, is, you know, we can't take you from 0% ready to take the test to 100% in an hour.
Right.
That would be awesome.
If you know how to do that, please let me know. That'd be great.
If we could somehow package that, we'd be very wealthy people.
Exactly.
But what we hopefully can do is we're hoping that you're maybe 80 to 90% there, and we can give you that little nudge towards 100%, and at least give you the information so that you can go out and maybe we get you to 95%, and then you go do the rest of what you need to do and go get 100% ready and go take and pass that test.
That's right.
So the first step in those four steps that we just took a look at was the, you know, as far as identifying the certification. So let's take a look at the different Microsoft certifications. And you'll see here that we have the pyramid that we like to use.
Yes.
And
we start from the foundation.
That's right. We start from that foundation, from the bottom of the pyramid, where you go for your Microsoft Certified Solutions Associate, MCSA. Now, this is the certification that we are focused on here, okay? And we'll see that in a moment. We're going to see how the 70-412 exam relates to the MCSA certification. But just to give you an idea of where you advance from there, we then have the MCSE, which is the Microsoft Certified Solutions Expert. Okay, that's the next level up, where you go from being an associate to an expert.
Right. You get into topics like cloud technology.
That's right. And then after the expert level, that's, you know,
I like to call it the guru level.
Yeah, we've been talking about
boss
this.
Boss level.
You know, I'm telling you, after today, Microsoft's really going to consider this. Is I think the top level, although we saw there a moment ago, it was the Microsoft Certified Solutions
Master.
Right? You've mastered something, and there's nothing wrong with that. I think MCG would be good. Microsoft Certified Guru.
I just really like that word, guru.
I do, too. Yeah. I think that would be great. Yeah. And I will tell you, if you are an MCSM, you are considered to be a guru. You really are. You are considered to be the absolute master of that technology. Mm-hmm. So now, if we go ahead and move forward into the specifics of how the MCSA is put together, you'll see here, or here.
Yeah. A little slow transition there.
Yeah, I don't know. I think the computers are a little tired right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, so end of the day. It wants a nap.
Yeah, end of the day, you know what? People are just waking up and watching this right now. It's the beginning of their day. So maybe it's the end of our day. But the MCSA is made up of three exams, as we see here, the 410, the 411, and 412. And although, yes, it seems like simple knowledge that you would take 410, then a 411, then 412 in that order, it's not a requirement. You can take them in any order you like. Now, that said, I would strongly recommend probably 410 and 11. I don't care if you maybe you switch those around if you need if you feel more comfortable with 411, but 412, because we are now getting into the advanced services, it really is considered to be something that you would do after 410 and 411. But once you have taken those three exams, you do then become an MCSA. And if we could take a look back here again real quick, you'll see here that for each of these exams, now, we put approximations here because this stuff changes over time. But just so you have an idea, for each of these exams, you're looking at about 50 questions, and you get about 2 to 3 hours per exam to do those 50 questions. And I will tell you that if you are prepared, that should be plenty of time. Now, we are going to talk to you in the latter half of this session about certain issues where maybe time becomes an issue and how you can deal with those issues.
Some tips and tricks.
Yeah, absolutely. But for the most part, yes, you should have plenty of time when you go to take the exam if you are prepared. It's the unprepared people who typically run out of time and they go, oh, you know, if they would have given me 4 hours, then I would have been able
there
to go ahead.
There is no way.
You know,
if you don't know your stuff, it doesn't matter how much time you have. It's not going to help you. So that's plenty of time.
Yeah, so, and the one last piece of information that we were looking at there is that you also only need a 700 as your passing score.
Yes.
And what this means is there's two things I want to tell you about this.
Number one. Does that mean 70%?
Well, that's number two I was going to say, but we'll make that number one now. Number one is it's not necessarily 70%. It is a relative number. So that you can gauge how well you did on the exam. And for the most part, I will tell you, that gauge should only be used if you, unfortunately, which we know this won't happen to anybody, but if you fail the exam. Because if you fail the exam and you get a 680, well, you know that you probably were pretty close. You take a look at the objectives that you were weak in, because you'll see that on your score sheet. It'll show you a little bar that shows you whether you did, how well you did on that particular objective. Then you go back and do a little studying, and then you're ready to go again. Whereas if you got, let's say, a 280, well, now
that's
you need to go back and really hit the books hard. Whereas if you pass, you know what? I don't care if you get a 700 on the button. I don't care if you get an 800.
A thousand,
it doesn't matter. A 700 or higher, you have passed. I mean, one of the old sayings that we used to say in the classroom all the time is what do you call a medical student who graduates last in their class?
A doctor.
Right? I mean, I suppose occasionally when you go to a doctor, you might look at what school they went to.
See if it was better.
But for the most part, if they have their diploma and they've gotten their medical degree, you don't ask what score did you get on the test, right? So it's kind of the same thing here. And I can tell you, even as a trainer, okay, so even as a Microsoft certified trainer, there is not a single job that I've had over the last 15 years where I've ever been asked what score I got. All they want to see is my transcript and know that I am certified in the things that I'm teaching.
And the amount of exams we've been taking, I don't think you'll even remember.
I
went through a lot of tests.
I have no idea what I got on my tests. None whatsoever.
It's one of those stacks of paper somewhere.
Yes. Or, yes.
Yeah.
Hidden behind the certificate on my wall. I think that's where I keep them. But anyway,
wow,
so that's point number, what I was going to say was point number two. Point number one that I wanted to get at was that because it's a 700, it's not a perfect score. So whereas it may not be 70%, I can tell you that 700 will never represent 100% either. Microsoft is not expecting you to have 100% knowledge to pass these tests. They know that nobody knows everything. So I know some people say I know everything. I don't know, but that no.
I wonder who said that.
I think it was me actually. I think
not
I said
me.
That. I know everything. So outside of me, you know, then no one knows everything. So that's just a good
close.
Thing to know.
Pretty close.
Now, one other real quick thing here when it comes to certification is besides the three exams. If you are already experienced and already certified as an MCSA in Windows Server 2008, you do have the option, instead of taking the 4, 10, 11, and 12 exams, you can take a single upgrade exam, which is the 417 exam. And this exam really kind of focuses on what we've talked about in all three of the exam preps that we've put together here with the 4, 10, 11, and 12, and really focuses on the things that are new to Windows Server 2012.
Right.
Now, this is where I get to throw my little plug in.
Yes, do
it. At the
it.
Bottom of the screen, and we're going to need to change the screen, but not yet. At the bottom of the screen, there is a link, the URL that we've given you that will take you to a jumpstart that I did with Rick Claus. And this jumpstart was specifically designed. It's 12 approximately one-hour sessions that we put together to help you to prepare for this 417 exam. So if we want to go ahead and switch to the next slide here, yes, if you're wondering who Rick Claus is and what he looks like, well, you can tell I'm still the crazy bald guy just as I am here today. So yes, Rick is the one in the crazy green hat. So anyway, I welcome you to go out there and watch that jumpstart if that is where your interests lie. I mean, I don't want you to run away from this exam prep that we're talking about right now.
Not yet.
But if you do, as an extra resource, please go ahead and watch those jumpstarts. They are free.
Yeah, and you brought up a really great point, noticing that some of these topics were focused for even just the quick prep took 2 days for you guys, right? So this 1 hour, 75-minute session is really, think of this as a checklist. This is, you've been studying, you just want to have an overall look of, you know, what else am I missing? What else do I need to study on? And, of course, some tips and tricks on what are some of the things I can do before the exam, during the exam, to get myself ready for it.
Yeah, and that is so just amazingly true is, I mean, here's the thing. That jumpstart that we did, it was basically taking 15 days worth of classroom material, condensing it into a five-day class, meaning that's what the 417 class is to begin with. We're taking 15 days and condensing it for the upgrade people into 5 days.
And
then Rick
again.
And I condensed that into 2 days. So it's a very fast-paced thing. What we've done here today with this exam prep is we're taking a five-day class and condensing it into an hour.
Even less than that.
Right, which means we
so this is a hit highlight.
Yeah. We can't actually teach you all the technologies. That's why we said we can't take you from zero to 100% ready. What we're going to do is make sure that you're very clear on the objectives, and then also beyond that, because those objectives will help you to know where your gaps might be. We'll also give you some exam tips and tricks, which a lot of people have been asking for, because a lot of people, that's what they're missing. When you talk about finding the gaps, that's their gap is they're like, you know, I've been using the product and I know the technologies, but I just don't know how to take a test.
Yes. Yes, so, I hear that. Yes.
Yeah. So we've given some tips and tricks in all of our exam preps, and we're going to try to hit those maybe even a little harder this time around to make sure we cover everything and give you everything that you need to just stop making those excuses and go out there, take that test, and pass that test. Now, in order for us to have time to get those tips and tricks, we need to get through the objectives. So let's go ahead and take a look at these now, and you'll see that the objectives for the 70-412 exam, there are six sections. They actually refer to them as objective domains. I like to stay away from the word domains because that's also a technological term in the operating system. But
that's
basically,
right. We want to avoid that.
These are the six objective domains. That's the last time I'm going to say it. We're just going to call them sections. These are the six high-level sections where we have configure and manage high availability, configure file and storage solutions, implement business continuity and disaster recovery, configure network services, configure the Active Directory infrastructure, and configure identity and access solutions. And although there is still some overlap, some redundancy, just to use both of our terms, with the 410 and the 411, whereas those two really overlap each other, this one is overlapping.
Not as much.
It's overlapping by title only, whereas you're really looking at the advanced side of those technologies that we previously, you know, just needed to maybe know the basics of how to install, the basics mm-hmm. of how to configure it. Right. Now we're going to get into some of the more sophisticated stuff. Mm-hmm. So if we take a look at the first objective, we'll see here that this is all about configure and manage high availability. So obviously, we're definitely getting into an advanced level here, right? Yes. Meaning there are plenty of administrators out there who can install a server, mm-hmm. they can configure a server, they can get DNS going, they can get DHCP right. going, they can get all that stuff going, and it's great. Mm-hmm. But high availability is a whole nother animal in itself. And as right. a matter of fact, this used to be, if you go all the way back, and Cynthia, you may remember better than I do. I can't remember if you have to go all the way back to NT. I don't think you do. I think if you go back to 2000, and they may even mm-hmm. had a little bit in 2003, that was a separate certification in itself.
Yes,
just clustering and high availability.
Very different, yes.
Yeah, so you know the first part that, you know, that's been around for a long time is mm-hmm. network load balancing. Mm-hmm. Right? And that has to do with your networking services, and you know, instead of having just one DNS server, let's say, to service everybody, you can have multiple DNS servers, and you can distribute the load, thus right. the name load balancing.
A little bit of redundancy in service. You can right. either protect from failure or just have a load balancer so that you can distribute the amount of workload yeah. that's around.
Web servers, you see that a lot. Mm-hmm. Yep. Web servers, you see that distributed. But what we're going to get into here, mm-hmm. What this exam gets into, is truly the all-out failover clustering
yes.
and really making sure that you are creating a highly available environment.
Yes.
Now, Cynthia, I know that you, being a PFE, which I always forget what that stands for. I know it's Premier Field Engineer.
Engineer yeah.
But more specifically, working with Exchange mm-hmm. on such a regular basis, obviously, mm-hmm. this is something that is crucial for your line of work.
Yes.
So
yeah.
I will shut up a little bit and let you maybe explain this a little bit.
Yes. So high availability, you hear that word a lot. Sometimes you represent it as HA. The fact that this is really the foundation service for any kind of redundancy, business continuity that you're interested in application level. So on the operating system level, you have things that you need to configure, things you need to install. And from Exchange's point of view, it's really leveraging the operating system. On the Windows Server 2012, we're looking at things like cluster-aware updating service. That's something that administrator that work with clustering, that's one of their pain points, perhaps, previously, that you want to keep your servers highly available, but every time you need to patch the server, you kind of have to do a little bit of a two-step dance just to make sure the nodes are consistent. You're not introducing any problems because you're causing outages. So this is something that 2012 really does quite well, really makes it shine. So that's one of the features we want to look at.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the other main thing here that Server 2012 really addresses is right down at the bottom, talking mm-hmm. about virtual machine movement.
Yes.
So looking at highly available servers from a virtualization perspective.
Yes. It is a movement. Everything is moving towards being yes. virtualized.
the fact that, it, you know, and
it's
on,
like
on
moving
that slide,
to the cloud. Yeah.
The last words on that slide actually said VM movement or
yeah.
virtual machine
yeah.
movement. And that's exactly it. It is a movement.
I love that. It sounds like a revolution.
It is.
Starting.
It is a revolution.
Yeah. Yeah.
This whole
it's
virtualization.
Happening. Yes.
They've been trying, you know, virtualization is something that, you know, technology experts have been trying to push so hard. Mm-hmm. I'd say the big push probably started about 5-6 years ago, 2006, 2007-ish. And I know it goes back further than that technically,
yeah.
but the big push started then, and it's taken them 5-6 years for us to finally get to a place where this is here. I mean, this mm-hmm. is now, and this is how our servers are going to be run. So we need to know how to work with that level of mm-hmm. high availability as well.
Right, and not just focusing on, you know, what is available in Server 2012, huge improvement in Hyper-V. In fact, depending on who you talk to, it feels like this is a brand new Hyper-V. It's very
well. It
different.
Is a brand new
yeah,
Hyper-V.
Yeah, it feels like
Hyper-V
wow.
3.0.
Yeah, that's right. To the future. So here we want to look at some of the concepts, and we want to make sure configuration-wise, not only installation we talked about previously for Hyper-V, but now you're configuring components into Hyper-V. You're making sure that your virtual images are supported well. You want to make sure that there are extendable disks that you can use and so forth. So this is something that you do want to focus on, not only on the tool itself, but look at other supporting tools such as PowerShell. This is one thing that all of us administrators kind of get used to or spoiled with graphic interface. We forget that, oh, there's a PowerShell tool that we can also use. So consider that as well.
Absolutely. And, you know, and here's the thing, I was about to cut you off anyway. here's the thing.
And there's one more cool thing.
Cynthia, yeah. You know, we could easily talk, not just for the entire hour on high availability. Mm-hmm. I mean, we could sit here and talk to you for an entire week on high availability. So this is the
kind of cool Hyper-V is.
Yes, if this is something that you are weak in, mm-hmm. It's going to take you a little time. You're not going to run out and take the test tomorrow after watching this. If you don't know high availability, if you don't know failover clustering, mm-hmm. I can't teach you in the next 5 minutes, mm-hmm. maybe in the next 5 hours. But we don't have 5 hours to teach you. So it is something that you are going to want to go out there, use your resources, and get real up to date on it, because mm-hmm. it's a big deal.
Yeah. And there's a difference between reading about Hyper-V, reading about high availability on the concept level, on the theory level. It's quite another thing to use the tools and be comfortable with what kind of interface is coming up, what kind of settings you're allowed to change, and what the impact of changing those settings are. So as Ed mentioned earlier, use the resources such as the Virtual Academy, the Microsoft Virtual Academy, and just get used to using those tools. If you happen to attend maybe an official curriculum, the mock courses, you would definitely see that because that's how we run the labs.
Yeah, yeah. Although I will tell you, I always tend to feel that, just personally, mm-hmm. that the high availability aspect in the classroom mm-hmm. is very similar to something we talked about in the 411 exam prep mm-hmm. With monitoring. It's kind of anticlimactic in the classroom because you're learning the concept.
Yeah.
You do get to play with a lab mm-hmm. and you get to see it, but it's a lab and you know that it's a pre-designed lab. Whereas when you implement high availability and you figure it out, you work through your struggles and you figure out that high availability solution mm-hmm. in a production environment, you kind of get that rush.
You get a high.
Wow,
yes. Yeah.
This is very cool.
This is how
I
it's supposed to work.
I can pull this plug right here.
Yeah.
And everything keeps working. That's really cool.
Not in production environment. That would be crazy.
But if you
actually,
do it right, you could.
Yeah, you could. Nobody would notice.
I'm not saying you
That's
would.
That's one way to test
you
it.
You could. So.
Yes.
Anyway, like I said, we could talk about this all day. So let's go ahead and move along. Mm-hmm. And we'll go into our next objective here, which is configuring file and storage solutions. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so now we talked about file and storage in the 410 and in the 411, but again, it came down to more of the basics of your shares mm-hmm. and your NTFS permissions. Mm-hmm. We did mention about access-based enumeration, and we mentioned something back then about dynamic access control and how it was related, and that's what we get into here as far mm-hmm. as this brand new, but super cool, and I'm not going to lie. It's not an easy, it's not like a quick wizard, next, and boom, I have dynamic access control.
There's definitely planning involved.
It takes some effort to set up a good dynamic access solution. And this is something that, for the same reason, mm-hmm. You're going to have to work a little harder at getting to know it as well.
Right.
But it is something that, in the end, I mean, it's expected that by the next generation of server that this may be the norm. Mm-hmm. It's not designed to take the place of NTFS permissions. Mm-hmm. It's designed to be a supplement to NTFS permissions.
Good word. It is supplement.
Yeah, it came up with a good word.
Yeah, that's a very good word.
Couldn't come up with one earlier, but I came up with one now.
What's
that
word? What's the word? Yes. So basically looking at not just getting used to assigning permissions based on things like user object, the SID of a user object, really that's what we used to do. Now we're available to have expression-based. So we have set claims. We can basically tag files and classify them. And that's how the permission is going to be implemented now. So from administrator point of view, great, because previously there was no way for us to say, you know what, just any kind of files and folders on this particular server's top secret server, everything needs to be locked down, the highest level possible. I want to have a proper access control list to control that. We have that ability now.
Yeah, absolutely.
With DAC.
So, and even beyond that, you know, in this general section, in this mm-hmm. general section of objectives, when it comes to actual file store and storage mm-hmm. solutions, I mean, there's things like the NFS data store. We got branch cache. Now, that's not new, but now we've said this in all of our exam preps. You still have, unless you're taking the upgrade exam, if you're taking these individual exams, you have to make sure you don't forget the basics. So if you have worked with a prior Windows operating system where we do have some of these functions, don't forget about them. Don't just put them on the shelf thinking, well, that was just Server 2008. Nope, it's still here in Server 2012, and you're going to be challenged on it on the exam.
Yeah. So, and my folk has always been telling people, just get used to the graphic interface. It's the same tools you'd be using. You might feel like that and thinking, this is not a new feature. I've used it before. I set it up before. I worked before. Go back to 2012 version of the interface and look at it again. So get familiar with that.
Yeah. So, and I guess the same thing could be held true for the storage solutions.
Yes.
As far as understanding that we're not just talking about, you know, in the earlier exams, 410, 411, we're talking about partitions and volumes.
Right.
And then we're talking about basic local storage, whereas now we're talking about iSCSI and ISNS and all sorts of advanced storage solutions.
Right.
Because again, what we're really doing is we're getting in this exam, in the 412 exam, just kind of put some context into it. Mm-hmm. We are getting closer. We're not quite there yet. We're just one little step away. We're getting closer to that true enterprise environment.
Yes.
Okay. Now, the real enterprise environment, when you really need to start looking at things from a big enterprise level, is when we get into the expert level certification. Okay. So it's what you would do after you take the 412 and after you become an MCSA. But the 412, it's funny, I actually kind of look at it, and I don't know if this is, I'll be curious if certain people in Microsoft Learning here, what they would think of this way of thinking, but I think of the 412 exam almost kind of like middle school, or depending on where you're from, it's middle school or junior high, in the sense that...
One step up.
Yeah, it's...
Yeah, you even graduate to that degree.
Yeah, it's like it's part of the MCSA. Mm-hmm. Which, similar to, and again, school districts are going to be different all around the country and all around the world, but for where I'm from, you know, when you're in middle school or junior high, you're still considered to be part of grade school. It's that top end of grade school where, you know, it's almost kind of like the 412. You're still part of the MCSA, but it's preparing you for
the next
high
level.
School. It's preparing you for the next level. Yeah. And that's kind of how I look at the 412 exam in this track as well.
And the feel.
Getting you ready for the next level.
Yeah, the feel of the exam is different. Whereas earlier we mentioned 410, 411 overlap in some of the objectives. You go from the initial configuration to administering the day-to-day operations. Now we're looking at detailed services where it might not be a services that you implement in your environment. So if you only have working knowledge of Server 2012, I like to call it the Swiss cheese knowledge. You have holes in there because there's some things you never touch at work, so this is where you're focusing on. You mentioned iSCSI earlier, so we're looking at, in 2012, your ability to say, you know, I have all these free space floating everywhere with the other servers that I don't use. So all of a sudden, you get used to tools such as the server manager and be able to create another initiator, be able to point to another location as your extra disk space that you can use. And the benefit, of course, using that in 2012 is there's no dedicated, you know, we were talking about SAN storage. There's no dedicated wiring to worry about. You're using your basic IP network.
You remember that?
It's great.
You remember, not just in the real world, but even the classroom world, you know, trying to demo something when you had to have all the dedicated wiring in a dedicated box.
Oh, that's just painful.
And a dedicated,
that's absolutely painful.
It's ridiculous. That's all a thing of the past now, though. It's just a thing of the past, which is amazing.
Yeah, it's really great. And the benefit also from the exam point of view, from studying point of view, you can now simulate networks, simulate enterprise setups fairly easily. So you can understand concept a lot better, whereas previously you only read about it, maybe look at some diagrams about it, but not really get your hands dirty and implement it. You can now. You have these tools.
And would you say that's also part of the whole virtualization
movement? It's the movement,
yes.
Yeah, and that's why you'll see things talking about from physical to virtual to P to V. And if you're transitioning from virtual machine to another virtual machine, you can, the V to V move, that's all there. Yeah.
Awesome. So that kind of gives you an idea of, you know, the what they're going to hit you with on the file and storage. So if we move along, the next item we have here is implementing business continuity and disaster recovery.
Big words.
Woohoo!
Big words for enterprises that just want to have 24/7 availability, nothing ever goes down, or if there's any kind of maintenance happening, nobody should notice it.
Yeah.
Well, other than the administrators, nobody else, the user, should not notice that any service is not available.
Right. Well, and you know, and it's funny because this is exactly what you're saying. Is this kind of almost falls into, even though if you look at the specifics, if you go onto Microsoft's website and you see the specifics under these objectives, this is a little bit different than the high availability objective. But it kind of almost falls into that high availability.
It's a continuation
objective.
Of that.
It is a continuation.
Really. Yeah.
They should have been next to it. They shouldn't have been skipping the file and storage in between. Because, business continuity and data recovery, a lot of people think of that as strictly just backup recovery.
Backup recovery, yeah.
But backup recovery is part of your high availability solution.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, if data is lost, business is closed.
Yeah.
Unless you can get it back up and running.
Yeah.
Or unless you have some kind of a fault-tolerant solution to where you don't ever realize, or the end user doesn't realize that data, you know, I shouldn't say the data is still there, but the system has gone
down.
The
server has gone, and they're attaching to a different server now. They shouldn't be able to tell the difference.
Yeah, so again, you know, we do have some basics that you got to keep in mind here when it comes to just simple, I mean, it is backup recovery, so you do need to be familiar with backup and recovery solutions, but you also have to understand some of the newer concepts in Windows Server 2012 when it comes to full server recovery, virtual machine recovery. I mean, even again, some of the
basics. So much nicer.
You got snapshots.
So much nicer.
So nice with your virtual machines.
Yeah.
I had mentioned earlier in another exam prep, I had mentioned about domain controllers, how they can now be virtualized, which really helps in business continuity. You know, just losing a domain controller, but having another one spun up before anybody realizes the first one is gone. So there's a lot of really cool stuff here. And, you know,
And they're really supplementary.
It kind of blows my mind.
Yeah, they're all really supplementary. So you're not looking at just solely focus on just backup or restore as a way of protecting your servers, protecting the data from loss. But on top of that, you have the high availability on top of this, and you have the virtual machine environment where you can have snapshots. So all these technology layer together give you a full protection, multi-layer protection, to make sure that business continue as usual.
Absolutely. And, you know, there is one buzzword and one technology that I will throw out there for anyone who's not aware.
I love buzzwords.
Windows Online Backup. That's something that is, I believe,
it's a
new
buzzword,
I don't think.
And it's a great feature to supplement your current backup and restore.
Yeah. Yeah.
Technology.
Yeah. Yeah, it's huge. It's huge. All right, so let's move along into the next objective here.
Oh,
and,
sure.
And
yes.
we are moving fairly quickly through these objectives because, again, in this particular environment, because we are talking about advanced services, there's only so much we can do to actually try to teach technology. There's really no time here. Each one of these things take a whole day, you know, to potentially to teach in detail. So we want to really kind of focus on that, and then we're going to get into some exam tips and tricks to really get you out there.
Yeah.
So the next objective we have is configuring network services. So we have, you know, the first one we have here is implementing an advanced dynamic host configuration protocol, or
good
DHCP,
old DHCP
solution. Yeah. Now, we're not talking about DORA anymore.
No,
okay?
we moved past DORA. We graduated. DORA grew up.
Yeah.
Okay?
There you go. I like that. I'm going to use that. DORA. This is DORA.
DORA
all
grew
grown up.
Yes.
Yeah, DORA, if you're not familiar with it, and you should be if you've already taken the 410 and or 411 exams. Actually, I think that would be just 410. Mm-hmm. But basically, it's the, you know, the actual way that DHCP flows, as far as the actual flow of communication between the client and the server. What we're talking about here with these advanced solutions is talking about, and this is something that's brand new and really awesome and I think long overdue, and that is having DHCP failover built right in.
Yes.
Okay?
You can have a hot standby.
It was thought for so many years, you know, people kind of had this who cares type attitude towards DHCP. So what if it goes down? The people who already have their IP address will keep it. And it's not like we have people coming, not like new computers coming on all the time needing IP addresses. So if I lose a DHCP server for a while, so what? I'll just spin up another one. It'll take over the scope of IP addresses, and we're good to go. Well, in today's day and age of BYOD, right, bring your own device, we do have devices coming on
all
like
the time.
This.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all the time. And so what we need to look at is a couple things. We have our super scopes, which we've had all along. This is not new. But it's so much more important now because we might need to go ahead and have these two or more scopes that we bring together into one pool. We have our multicast scopes, And then also, like I said, specifically the DHCP failover, and I'm blinking out. It's the split scopes.
Mm-hmm.
Split scopes.
Yeah.
Thank you. The split scopes.
I was wondering when you're going to get to that.
Yeah, I was like.
What's the word?
What's the word? It's right in the brain. Oh, it's split scopes. And here's what I think is very cool about split scopes for someone like me who's been teaching this stuff for nearly 15 years. Since I started teaching DHCP, there has always been a method of failover put in place called the 80-20 rule.
Yeah, and it's done manually.
It's completely done manually. It's the idea of having this, you have one scope of, let's say, 100 IP addresses, and you have one DHCP server. We're just going to fish this in a whole other language. But
right.
One DHCP server that would have 80 of those addresses, mm-hmm. and another one that would have, both would have the entire 100 addresses, mm-hmm. but one would have an exclusion for 20 of them, mm-hmm. and then the other server would have all 100, but have an exclusion for 80 of them. And so obviously the one that has 80% would be mm-hmm. kind of your primary, the one that mm-hmm. you were counting on, and only if it failed would things kind of kick over to the other one. But it was all completely manual.
Mm-hmm.
Now, split scopes pretty much just takes care of it for you.
Right.
You can actually go in and set it up so that DHCP automatically recognizes there's another server over there, mm-hmm. it's also a DHCP server, and I want that server to have 20% of my scope.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little more, I don't know, automated is not the word I'm looking for. I would say supported.
Mm-hmm.
It's a yep. way of DHCP now supporting that mm-hmm. 80-20 rule. Now, beyond that, we'd also have true DHCP failover.
Yes.
Where we can go ahead and actually have standby and all that so that you have two DHCP servers and they actually both know about the entire scope
mm-hmm.
and they stay in touch with each other. So they both know about the addresses that have been handed out. They know the leases, the reservations.
Right.
The other one can just go ahead and keep things going.
Continue going, yes. So very cool.
That is one of the definite things they've added in.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when it comes to DNS, which is another advanced networking service, it's another networking service, but the advanced version, I'm just going to say one word. And if you don't know what this is, you're going to need to go
learn it. You need to go look it up now.
It's DNSSEC.
Yes.
Okay, DNSSEC,
mm-hmm.
which stands for DNS security.
Mm-hmm.
And you are going to need to be familiar with, you're going to have to understand encryption and keys and
mm-hmm.
certificates.
DNS keys.
And it's basically a way of securing your DNS servers. Mm-hmm. And why is this important? Well, let's see. What are
DNS poisoning?
Yeah, there you go. What are some of the most common, you think of some of the big takedowns that you've seen mm-hmm. of companies where their websites are down. Guess what? Most of those attacks these days are denial of service attacks.
Mm-hmm.
And to be more specific, they are these sophisticated distributed denial of service attacks.
Mm-hmm.
And to be specific beyond that, on DNS servers.
Mm-hmm.
That's where these attacks are taking place because people have realized you take down DNS and
nobody can resolve to your site. And all of a sudden,
you know what
not.
That is.
Yeah.
Because I mentioned this in another exam prep. Because and I'm pointing at myself so that you don't get offended.
We can't memorize numbers.
We are stupid humans. We only know names.
Right.
We can't remember IP addresses. So I can't even get the name straight sometimes. What about an IPv6 address?
Yeah.
Good luck remembering
that. Memorize that one.
Yeah.
128 bits.
And that is another advanced service, by the way, that I will mention mm-hmm. with both DHCP and DNS,
mm-hmm.
which is support for IPv6.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessarily as advanced as far as what you need to know. But it is something that you also do need to know.
So you're looking at, for the advanced services side, you're looking at securing the records and you're looking at high availability of these services so that you don't cause any outages in your environment.
Absolutely. And, there is one other category, and I would love nothing more than to walk out of the studio right now and have Rick Claus sit down right now.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Rick, where are you?
Yeah.
Are you here? No? Should I grab his hat and put it on? But IPAM.
Yes.
So IP address management, yes.
Yeah.
The reason I say I'd love to bring Rick in is because this is something that Rick just loves to talk about. He's really high on. And I think rightfully so.
Mm-hmm.
It is really exciting. It's.
Mm-hmm.
I know you said it earlier, Cynthia. I loved what you said when we were talking about this. It's like taking the manual spreadsheets that we used to all keep
You know how administrators are.
Automating it.
Yeah, we're trying to do a good job, the day-to-day work, and we want to make sure which address is used, which address is not used, which reservation we've been using, which scope. You know the old ways when I want to use an IP address? I ping it to see if it responds. If it doesn't, maybe I can use that. That's just not the way to do it. So administrator come up with spreadsheets. And now with IPAM, you don't have to have those manual spreadsheets to manage those IP addresses, what's available, what is not available. And this is almost like a documentation service for you, what's available in your environment.
Right. And you know, and a lot of it has to do with integration with DHCP and DNS and having everything play nice. Because we have these services at our disposal, right? We have DNS, we have DHCP, and if you look at the functionality, in your head, you know, if you've been working with this stuff as long as we have, we've already been thinking, why don't they have something like IPAM?
Right. Why can't I manage IP blocks?
Yeah. And well, guess what we do? It's here now.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Bonus.
And there's reporting.
Reporting.
Yeah.
You
I'm
and the
nuts
reporting.
About reporting. Yeah, I want to know what's going on the network.
Absolutely. Yeah. All right, so if we move along into the next objective, this is where we get into configuring the Active Directory infrastructure. And I have to say right out the gates that this is something that is going to look, if you talk about just the name, configuring the Active Directory infrastructure, well, it sounds like the same objective we saw in both 4.10 and 4.11. But in this case, again, you have to think of it from a context of this is the advanced side of it.
Yeah.
This is where we start really getting into. I know I started to pound this out back in the 4.10 example, but planning.
Planning.
Right? It's all
this
about
is
planning
a big one.
Your forests and your domain and your sites and having this all in place. Mm-hmm. And I'd mentioned that when we get to the more advanced stuff, and really we get into it when we get to the expert level stuff, but like I said, this is like middle school. It's getting us ready for that level. You have to start understanding the planning and the designing of your Active Directory infrastructure. Mm-hmm. And beyond that, I also mentioned earlier about some of the really new features that are built into Windows Server 2012 with Active Directory and its ability to be virtualized and its ability to so easily have different backup and recovery solutions.
Yes.
And these are all the various things that we really need to take a look at when it comes to the overall configuration of the Active Directory infrastructure.
Right, and to help you move along with such as domain migrations, you want to make sure that you look at the 2012 tools, you realize, wow, we've done it manually for so long, and this is beautiful.
Yeah, and it makes some of the stuff
easier
we have now
planning,
makes
the ADMT, implementation.
The old ADMT look like, what was that?
Yeah, what was that?
Doesn't that lead us into back into that CSVDE thing?
Yeah.
We won't go
Let's
there.
Let's get into that again, shall we?
Yeah. I will tell you that this is the one place, though, out of the three exams where we do kind of focus on sites and replication. So we get into
the physical
more of the
structure.
Physical structure of Active Directory, whereas in the 4.10 and 4.11, it's more of the logical. Mm-hmm. Now we're getting into the physical. It's so important to make sure that you have your sites and subnets set up properly. Make sure you have replication functioning properly. There's all sorts of new replication technologies. And these are things that are behind the scenes. These are things that you're not going to be tested on. You're not expected to even know they're going on behind the scenes.
To know how they work is really interesting.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And things like, and I know I mentioned this in the 4.11 exam prep, when we were talking about the global catalog, putting them in every branch. Mm-hmm. You know, in the past, you didn't want to do that because replication over a slow WAN link was terrible. Not anymore. Mm-hmm. Now the slow WAN link, it really is not as big a deal because the replication is so much more efficient now.
Yes. Yeah. And so. Monitoring replication and seeing how each individual site is talking to each other. You can do things like site connectors and the cost and all of that. So that goes into planning. That goes into understanding the big picture. And that's one thing that Active Directory, so far in the previous two exams, we focus on the more detailed things like users and computers and OUs. But now, zooming out in the big picture, how do you plan the whole forest? How do you make sure your DC placement is correct and it's optimized? And this is what we're looking at. tenant.
Yeah. And the one last thing I will also mention that falls into this realm right here is trust.
Yes.
And I know we kind of skipped it. It's the second item on the list
here.
But trust
is another. I don't know. Trust.
You don't trust me?
Trusted. Trusting.
Well, here we go. So let me ask you, if the arrow is pointing this way.
Yeah. Is it trusting Ed or is it trusting
you tell me.
Ed?
Do you know?
Do you remember?
I absolutely remember. It's I trust you.
Yes.
I trust your users to access my stuff.
Yeah. So resources
here. So you're looking
here,
at material and you see an arrow pointing from one domain to the other, that arrow means that this domain trusts that domain's people to access this domain's stuff.
Right.
Okay, that's a very, very important thing to always test or no test, just understanding how to build this stuff. That's so crucial.
And the reason for that is you have to configure those trusts. It's basically, we don't really talk about two-way trust. It's really two one-way trusts. So you have to understand which part is where the resource is coming from and which part are the people.
Yeah. Yeah, you remember, boy. Talk about dating ourselves, you know, back to...
Yeah, I know. We should just stop talking.
There literally used to be no such thing as a two-way trust.
Yeah.
It was actually two one-way trusts, whereas now... again, for
simplified,
stupid humans.
For
even though behind the scenes it's two one-ways.
Yeah, it does it for you.
For us, it just says it's a two-way.
Yeah, it does it for you.
So let's go ahead and jump quickly here to the last objective.
Yes, related to
I was about to say the D word after objective that I said I wouldn't say again, but we're in the middle of talking about
objective, yes.
And I will tell you, this last one here, configuring identity and access solutions. Now, here's the deal. What do we have here? Active Directory Federation Services. Mm-hmm. Active Directory Certificate Services.
And rights management.
The third bullet point there is managing certificates. That goes into ADCS. So really, there's kind of three main bullet points that should be here. And the third one is ADRMS, Rights Management Services. And this is something that, you know, in the way back, you know, when I did the 410 exam prep, I had mentioned how we talk about Active Directory generically.
Right.
We just say Active Directory, and we think we're talking about users and groups all the time.
No.
And I had made mention back in that exam prep, and I'll make it again now, that all that we've been talking about is Active Directory domain services. Mm-hmm. We do have these other aspects of Active Directory, which is federation services, certificate services, and right management services. And these are the kinds of things that I think this is where there's going to be a lot of gaps with a lot of people.
Yes, because it's not something that you implement easily in your environment. So unless your organization went through the whole PKI design and deployment, you probably never touched any of these advanced services. So your foundation knowledge really is at the certificate services and to manage the certificates and understand the individual components that contribute to the whole certificate, the public key infrastructure. And now all the other services go on top of it. Once you have the PKI in place, you can now talk about things like the rights management because you have the foundation in place.
Yeah, and that's a very good point when you tell as far as federation services, certificate services, rights management services. There's a lot of people who have been working with this stuff for a long time, but have never really had that real world chance to touch those things because you have to have the scenario that maps to it. So you know, here's the thing: when it comes to the exams, the older exams, you go back to 2008, 2003, 2000. You know, people would study for the thought that they might get one or two questions. Maybe.
Yeah, whereas not the case
now,
anymore.
This is 1/6 of the exam, right? This is one entire objective, we'll say section, because I said I won't say the D word. And so you want to make sure that you do take the opportunity. And one of the really cool things is we now have virtualization. So now you can emulate and set up, you know, an actual federated network. Whereas maybe you couldn't even play with that before unless you were lucky enough to work in an environment where there was a need for it.
Right. Or you've taken the official courseware and sat through the whole, what was it used to be, 3-day worth of Federation Service training?
So I'll tell you what, though. I personally think that one also falls into the realm that I mentioned earlier, that it was a little anticlimactic in the sense that you know that it's this lab environment. You know it's been preset up.
I get to federate two users. Wow, wait.
Right. So, but it's the kind of stuff that I'll tell you what, anticlimactic or not, do it.
Yeah.
Okay. Make sure you've touched it before you go take this exam. Don't just go, well, I know what ADFS is.
Yeah.
We're good. Yeah. I'm just going to take the test.
Yeah, you need to know the tools. So not just to conceptually understand the theory behind it, but actually see the tools and go through the steps of implementation. And because some of the things they come across will be understanding if you are going to deploy something like rights management, what needs to happen first? Does certificate happen first? Where do you create the digital keys? Which tool are you going to launch first? So all of that comes into play.
Very cool. All right, so I'll tell you what, that does bring us to the point where we've gone through all of the six high-level objectives.
Yeah. Hit highlights.
Yes.
Quick touching
and,
on
and you know what, I will tell you, there is a there's a link that we're going to give you at the end of this session to a web page where you can look at not only those six objectives, but where you can see where all the breakdown is of the individual details of those objectives to make sure that you really are getting what you need before you go and try to take this test. Mm-hmm. But before we get there, let's talk about something that I think is equally as important, maybe even more important, when it comes to really getting ready. You know, if you're watching this right now and you're getting ready to go take a test, we need to give you some of those exam tips and tricks. And you notice I said it nice
experience.
And slow and deliberate so I didn't stumble through those words. But yeah, so we've been talking about various exam tips as we talk to you about certain topics, but here we have some more specific exam tips. There's a few listed here. I'm going to go into a few more, actually, that I like to do.
Definitely.
Cynthia, you'll do
this
some
of your
own.
This is just a talking point. Yeah, just add your
and,
own.
You know, I actually want to say before we even get into this is that, you know, Cynthia and I are both, we've both been doing this for about the same amount of time. We took our first exams back in the
90s.
Oh, we're old.
Yeah.
And
no, you're old. I never age.
I know. And we both had a lot of success. But what we realized just recently, just yesterday, we were having a casual conversation, and we realized we're actually very different in our style in how we get ready for the exam, and more specifically, how we take the exam, right? Mm-hmm. When we get into that exam room, there is something about us that we learned about each other that's very different. And what's very cool about that is showing all of you who are watching right now that there are things you'll relate with me, and there's things you're going to relate with Cynthia, and that's okay, meaning you don't have to be the same exact, you know, regimen of, well, this is what Ed told me I have to do if I want to pass the test.
Yeah.
No, I've always said this over the years. You need to figure out what works for you.
Yeah.
So let's look at some of these tips. Before the exam, right, when you're getting ready for the exam, I love the very first bullet point that we have there, which is set a date. It's all about goal setting. If you just say, I'm going to take the test sometime in the near future. And even if you're as generic, you could be specific to say, I'm going to take it the next 3 months. That's not specific
enough.
That's
not detailed enough. Yeah.
If I'm going to sit here right now and say, I'm going to take it in 3 months, fine. Then I'm going to look at my calendar and I'm going to go 1, 2, 3 months. That's how long it's going to take me. That's fine. But set the date and actually schedule that test.
Yeah.
Schedule it. You're on the hook now. I have to be ready to take that test.
And you're
put off forever.
Yeah, if you're anything like me, I can't study without a deadline. I need to know there's a deadline to aim for. If I'm just in the mindset of oh, I'll take the test when I'm ready, never going to happen.
are you saying you're a procrastinator?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I need to have a set date.
Because I'm the king of procrastination.
Oh, so, yeah? You want to compete on that one?
Well,
let's
how
see
about
that.
We just agree I'm the king and you're the queen and they all are, you know.
Sounds good.
Whatever.
Yeah, that's right. Prince and princesses.
I was going to say our jesters, but anyway.
Yeah. Okay.
You're much more, you know, you think.
I'm more diplomatic about it.
Yeah, much more diplomatic. So, you want to go ahead and set that big goal of I'm taking the test by this date. But you also want to set some smaller goals. Because, again, if you're anything like me, I'm one of those people that I kind of need to see that light at the end of the tunnel. I kind of have to know everything or I know nothing. And that works against me. Now, obviously, I figured out how to get past that because I have been doing this a long time and I've passed a lot of tests. But it was a struggle for a long time. I had to learn to set individual goals to say, hey, this week I'm going to master this one objective, this one topic, this one thing that's been nagging me that I don't understand. I heard somebody talk about password setting objects, so I'm going to learn that this week. Set smaller goals rather than just try to learn everything, because that's, again, why I think that goes with the procrastination is that's why you feel you're never ready. It's because nobody ever knows everything. And that's another key tip that I'm going to kind of add in here is that's okay. You don't have to know everything. The more you know, the better. But remember, you only need a 700 to pass the test. You don't need a perfect score. Microsoft is not expecting you to answer every single question correctly if you are going to pass. They realize that no one knows everything. There's not a soul on this planet that can tell you every last thing about... there's some people who think they do.
Unless but, you want to settle a bet with your friends.
Yeah,
I'm
going to
get higher score than you.
Yeah, which, by the way, we really... We caution against that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess it's all fun if you want to set a bet with your friends and then you go in and say, I got this score, you got that score. Hey, hey, I know more than you.
Yeah.
You know what? Here's the problem. If you and I go in and take the test, same day even.
Different.
We can go sit in the seats right next to each other in the test center.
Different.
I may not see the same questions that you do.
That's a very good point because you know what? It's a big pool of questions that you're getting a subset of that. So one thing is definitely reminding people that, for example, you have to sign off on the NDA. You can't say what's on the exam, but even if you did, it wouldn't help you. So study.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So just... know as much as you know, be as prepared as you can be, but set that date and then just go do it. And you know, that kind of even leads into the next item here we have during the exam. The first bullet point says don't panic. And it goes right along with what I was just talking about with the, you know, the you don't have to know everything. It's okay to see a question and not know where they pulled that from.
Yeah.
Okay.
And don't let that throw you off. Move on.
Matter of fact, I can take it a step further and tell you that there is not a single exam, and I've taken at least, I don't even know the number, 30, 40 of these exams at least.
It's got to be more than that.
It might be more
90s.
Than that at this point. I stopped counting at about 30. That's when I stopped. So I know it's more than 30.
It's
I
when your transcripts start to take pages and pages and pages and pages. You just like, forget.
It's kind of like age. I stopped counting how old I was at 30 also. So I know you're not there yet. So you don't have to, you'll see when you get to 30, you stop counting. But really, every single exam, every single one, there was at least one question, at least one, where I just went, where did that come from?
And you know what? For me, that's
that.
Usually the very first question.
The very first. That's great.
It doesn't matter what the question is. The first question, you have that deer caught in the headlight look. And then you ease into it and think, oh.
Well, there's an easy solution to that.
Skip
it's called
it.
The next one.
Yeah, next.
Just skip it and
come back later.
To it later. That's another tip we're going to get into. And I will tell you, by the way, there is another important tip that I kind of skipped over, which is before the exam. Besides the tip about setting your goals and this and that, also getting your body ready for the exam. Get your brain ready for the exam. Always, and I know these are the things you've heard from your school teachers over the years and this and that, but get a good night's sleep. Eat a good meal, make sure you're hydrated. And I will tell you, I had this one nice young lady who came in once. She literally went, because we were a test center as well as a training center. When she was taking out her ID to show me so she could go in and take the exam, I mean, she could like barely even get it out of her wallet because she was shaking so much.
Yeah.
And I talked to her about what was going on, and she just said she was very nervous. So I started talking to her about calming her down, and as I'm talking to her to try to calm her down, because I knew she wasn't going to pass. I mean, she was destined to fail. She was so worked up. I come to find that she was so worked up about this test, she hadn't slept the whole night.
Oh.
She didn't eat breakfast.
Not good.
And she had barely had anything to drink. Mm-hmm. So she was now sleep-deprived, malnourished, and dehydrated.
Dehydrated. Oh, not good.
She was going to fail, period. Mm. And I actually refused to let her go into the exam. I this is a true story. I flat out refused, and she got mad at me. She said, "You can't stop me. I'm scheduled. I paid my money." And I said, "Trust me, you are going to thank me later." I refused. I said, "You cannot go in." I made her go in the back. I got her some water. I went to the vending machine, and I got her some snacks. Once she calmed down, I let her go in, and I found out after the fact. I didn't know this ahead of time because she was just angry at me ahead of time. Afterwards, she did come out and thank me. I didn't actually expect she was going to thank me when I said, "You'll thank me later."
Yeah.
She literally thanked me. And the reason is because, I didn't know this, but this was like her sixth shot at that test.
Oh.
She had already failed it 5 times prior. And she thanked me because she realized, wow, that is what I was doing wrong.
All she needed was rest and nourishment.
That's it.
Yeah.
So make sure that you do also take care of your body and your brain when you go for these tests. There's no reason to be this stressed out. If you fail the test, all it means is you have to take it again. That's it. And by the way, your transcript doesn't show when you failed an exam. It only shows when you passed an exam. So if you took that test, like for this one lady, when she took it 6 times, her transcript never reflected that. It just showed she passed the test. That's
it. Yeah, whenever you pass the test. Yep.
Now, I'm going to actually let you talk about the next thing, because this is something that we learned about, I learned about you,
right.
Is that when I take the test, I have a very different experience than Cynthia. So I'll let you share about, I go through the test very quickly. I take half the time.
Right.
What do you experience?
Yeah, I just want to talk about that. Some people worry about not having enough time to do these exams, and I want to assure you, you have enough time. In fact, if you know your stuff, you don't have a time problem. If you think about 50 questions, roughly 50 questions.
Wait.
About,
are you saying that when I go through the test, I know my stuff, and that's why I have plenty of time, and you don't, and that's why you run out of time?
If you know your stuff, you shouldn't have time issues. And even if you think about it, if you're evenly dividing it, time up, 50 questions, maybe 3 minutes per question, it doesn't sound like a lot of time. And that fact alone makes some people nervous. When I first started taking the exams, I always thought timing would be an issue, and I realized it's not. Even as I usually tell people that's taking the exam, I read very, very slowly. I'm an ESL. English is my second language. And also, I'm dyslexic. So I have to read slowly in order to not get the questions wrong. I had a couple of nightmare issues where I read the question the first time really quickly, answered it, moved on to the next one. Only upon review, I realized I missed the word not. That changed the whole thing. So read carefully, read slowly. If that's your reading style, that's your comprehension level, definitely you have enough time. And the other thing I like to do is instead of, watch your time, don't waste too much time on one single question. It's a good idea to pass through all of the questions at least once first. So the questions that you know the answer to immediately, select the answer for it and move on. Have at least see through all 50 or roughly 50 questions, you'll be able to have a better idea of answering some of the questions you're unsure of. So there could be a couple of possibilities.
Yeah.
One is you read the question and have no clue what they're asking. And that's a possibility because you will have a question with lots of padded information. For example, it's describing the whole network to you, describing the whole organization, what kind of business they're in, not relevant to the question, but it's padding. So able to read through that and just focus on the question itself. That's the first thing. You didn't understand what it's asking. The second one is maybe you understood the question perfectly well. You didn't quite get what the answers are all about. You have maybe four multiple choice, and they all look rather close to each other. And you know one of them is the right answer. Just not quite sure which one.
You hope.
Not quite sure which one. So in this case, what I usually do is I will mark the answer I'm most certain about. There's also a mark checkbox on top of the question. Select that and come back to it, visit it later. Do not dwell on that question. You could easily waste 10 minutes trying to figure out what this interpretation means, what that interpretation means. And it also, you think yourself into a corner.
Right.
You overthink it, and the question's not that complex.
Well, and I will tell you, there is one thing that we do actually agree on, even though we have a slightly different system because of the needs when we're going through the test.
Right.
We both agree that, I just don't answer it. If I answer a question, I answer it when I'm ready to answer it. Whereas Cynthia will answer
I will put something down.
And mark it to come back and review later. And the reason is because you're worried that you might run out of time.
Yes.
And
always give myself that extra.
Right. You want to answer every question. Because a question you don't answer is wrong. You get a zero.
You get a zero.
A question you answer, whether you knew it or not, you might have got it right and you got some points. Mm-hmm. Or you got it wrong and you still got a zero. But you're guaranteed that zero if you don't answer it, okay?
Yeah.
So, but here's what we agree upon, and that is, once you have answered a question, do not ever, with one exception that I'm gonna share in a minute, change that answer.
Mm-hmm.
One of the problems, and this is why I don't, even if I'm marking a question to come back to it, I don't like to answer it until I come back, is I have seen that people will answer a question, and then when they go back,
they'll
talk themselves out of it. Because you're overthinking it. And so you talk yourself out of that out of that answer. As a test proctor, I've watched people get a lot of answers right, go back and fail the test because they changed all their answers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I said I'd tell you one exception. That one exception is if there is something that's compelling you to do so. As in, sometimes you see a question 3 or 4 questions later, and there's some information in that question that jogs your memory and a light bulb goes off and you go, I answered that other one wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I thought I knew, but that's right. I remember that now. That's the only time I ever recommend that you change an answer. Otherwise, you're more likely than not, your gut had the right answer, your brain starts overthinking you into
yes.
the wrong answer.
Yeah.
Because remember, these are the questions, the ones you're going back mm-hmm. to, the ones you weren't sure about.
Yeah.
So your brain didn't necessarily know the right answer.
Right.
So,
yeah.
So that's pretty much the tips and tricks that we have for you. Mm-hmm. I know anyone who knows me knows I could talk to you for a whole another hour on tips and tricks on
you
exam
have.
Preparation.
You have done that before too. But there are other previously recorded sessions and
with my company, but yes.
Yeah.
But anyway, yes. No. Before we let you guys go, mm-hmm. we do want to wrap things up. We just have some links here real quick for you, starting with the Microsoft Virtual Academy. So basically, it's where it gives you the ability to go ahead, and if you are short on resources, it gives mm-hmm. you the ability to go ahead and have some of these virtual labs in place and learn
That's
stuff
right. yep.
Using our labs, using Microsoft Learning's labs, not
That's
my
right.
labs. The middle link there is the one that we showed you earlier
Jumpstart.
To the Jumpstart for the 417 mm-hmm. people, and the last one is the specific URL to the exam page. I mentioned mm-hmm. that we would talk about the page where you can get all the details for the exam.
About the 412.
Yeah, mm-hmm. that's right here on this page. And by the way, this is a long URL, and if you don't have to quickly write it down, you don't have to memorize it. If you just mm-hmm. go to microsoft.com/learning, mm-hmm. there's a whole newly redesigned web page, and it's so easy. There's a big button you can't miss that says certification.
Yeah.
From there, there's a big button that
right
says server certification, MCSA certification, yeah. and it'll take you right to the 412 exam. It's not hard to get to.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll tell you what, Cynthia, this has been fun.
Mm-hmm.
Hope it was
yep.
fun for you, and most importantly, I hope it was enjoyable and helpful for you. Wish you all the luck, but you won't need it because you're going to be prepared.
Yeah, you're going
to
be great.
And hope to see you again somewhere in the future with another exam prep.
Mm-hmm.